Discovering Alabama is a production of the Alabama Museum of Natural History.
This program is about a land unknown to many people, a land that in many ways has escaped the hustle and bustle of modern civilization, a place with bountiful backcountry, forests, streams, and wildlife more diverse than can be found in much of the inhabited world. Come along with me as we explore the natural wonders of this land. Come along as we discover Alabama.
Hello, folks. I want to welcome you to another program in the Discovering Alabama series. We're here somewhere on top of a hill in the middle of Alabama. Actually, we're out in the middle of the Talladega National Forest, Oakmulgee Division, which today I'm going to term our program A Walk in My Backyard, because I live on the edge of the Oakmulgee Division. And I want you to trek along with me. We're going to have a nice time, and we're just going to get down in it and experience it. Come with me.
The Oakmulgee Division of the Talladega National Forest is located in West Alabama and spans parts of five counties. Characterized mostly by rolling hills and hollows, the forest gets its name from Oakmulgee Creek, which flows through the region. Oakmulgee is an Indian word meaning bubbling waters. Covering over 154,000 acres, the Oakmulgee was established in the 1930s as the U.S. Forest Service arranged necessary purchases and owner relocations in order to acquire the then privately owned lands in the area. Though not the largest national forest in Alabama, the Oakmulgee produces the state's greatest annual yield of harvested timber, and therefore serves well for looking at several aspects of national forest management.
The Oakmulgee Division of the Talladega Forest really is my backyard, because this is the edge of my farm. And right out the back side of this is the forest. In fact, I've been working on my farm today. And if y'all can just roll with me, I'm going to just take off from work and we'll go visit the forest. But I'm dressed for my work, so hope it doesn't bother anyone. My dear dad, has been helping me with my work, and I'll give him a little bit of thanks on air, and my dear mom, too, for condoning me and my dad while we struggle with this. But the Oakmulgee is, in true fact, my backyard, and we're going to take a hike into it. The Oakmulgee is one of five national forests in Alabama, totaling over 600,000 acres. There's the Bankhead up in the northwestern part of the state, the Talladega Division of the Talladega National Forest near Cheehaw Mountain, the Kaneka way down in South Alabama, the Tuskegee east of Montgomery, and the Oakmulgee here, a little bit outside of Tuscaloosa. Each is different in several important ways, but I love all of them. Some people confuse national forests with national parks. National parks are not always forested areas to begin with, and then they're usually special lands with exhilarating appeal that are set aside for people to just enjoy for recreational purposes, and they frequently don't allow timber harvesting and other activities such as hunting sometimes. National forests, on the other hand, are managed by the U.S. Department of Agriculture, and they are typically multiple-use lands that are managed for such concerns as watershed protection, wildlife habitat, timber production, in addition to certain forms of recreation, including hunting.
The first forest reserves in the United States were established in the 1890s under Presidents Grover Cleveland and Benjamin Harrison. Prior to that time, America was witnessing what has since come to be called the Age of Extermination, when our frontier mentality led us to obliterate massive areas of forest land and to hunt scores of wildlife species to the point of extinction, and often for no better purpose than to boast over our reckless achievements. When the U.S. Forest Service was officially created around the turn of the century, their major aim was the preservation of existing forests and the replenishment of depleted lands. They've done a remarkable job bringing back healthy forests on many of the lands that were at one point severely ravaged and eroding.
We're down in a hardwood-covered hollow, and it's primarily oak-hickory hardwood mix down here, which is one of the more prominent types of forest cover that would exist in Alabama if we left it alone to turn to its normal species.
Roughly 865 species of trees can be found on the North American continent. Close to 20% of those species are native to Alabama, where, over most of the state, deciduous hardwood species constitute the dominant cover type if the forest is left unaltered.
This is one of those species of hardwood, and it's a red oak. Let me get a leaf off of this tree here. These are the two families of oak, the red oak family and the white oak family. Now, what do you notice is the major difference between those leaves? This one has rounded lobes, right? And this one has pointed lobes. And that's one of the more characteristic differences between the two families of oak, although there are many different species in each family. Both acorns, by the way, are edible. The red oak has a lot more tannin in it, though. The white oak is generally more usable for dining. Here is a big white oak, and you can tell by looking at the bark, those white plates of bark, that this is the classic white oak. And right over here is the hickory. This is a species of hickory. I believe it's the mockernut hickory. Here's a branch off of it so you can see the leaves. An interesting thing about the hickory is the leaves are symmetrical. Three on the end and then symmetrical as they go down the stem. They're finely serrated, elliptical-shaped leaves, and I guess you all know that the hickory nut is edible. I'm not sure that you may have known that the hickory leaf is edible. Tightly veined bark and a nice, heavy, feeling crown. Here's a couple of trees, by the way, that are frequently confused. Let's take a minute to just quickly talk about them. Which one looks the most like a starfish? This one does, and that makes it the sweet gum. This one is the maple. Sometimes people think this is the maple. That's a sweet gum, and this is a red maple. It's got a red stem, which is a common feature of it, and not as obviously a lobed leaf, usually, as a sweet gum. You know, an interesting thing about trees, the flowering trees, the fruiting trees, or angiosperms, are believed to be newer in the scale of time than some of the gymnosperms or the evergreen trees. The evergreens reproduce rather primitively. They cast their seeds to the wind, and the angiosperms are specialized. They have a particular color flower or a particular odor that almost attracts a specific insect to cross-pollinate. We even believe that some species of trees are still coming onto the scene. For instance, the hawthorn is believed to be a newer species of tree. We're in a piney area of the forest. It's a higher elevation, typically managed for pine out here, and I've collected some samples of the three of the common pines that grow out here. This is off the longleaf pine, needles in clusters of three, typically 8 to 18 inches in length. This one is off the shortleaf pine, needles in clusters of two, usually only 2 to 3 inches in length. And here's a mid-range one for you, off the loblolly. Clusters of three, typically, and grows 5 to 8 inches in length. I've got the cones from them also, and consistent with the length of the needles, the longleaf pine cone is the biggest, and that's the size of that one. The shortleaf pine cone is the smallest, and the loblolly is in the middle. We're standing in a longleaf pine area. This is actually has been planted in longleaf pine and is managed for longleaf pine. It's more of an upland area, whereas we were down in a low area with the hardwoods, and that's where you frequently find the hardwoods. It might surprise some people to realize that since we have, the public, have put such great demands for increasing timber products, now as much as 90% of our forest land acreage, our national forest acreage, is managed for timber production. And in areas like this, like in the Oakmulgee, perhaps two-thirds of the forest is growing pine timber. Atta boy.
Ah, here's a nice one. Nice, healthy rat snake. Boy, that is a healthy one. This is a gray rat snake. I've been looking for a king snake today, but I guess this one will have to suffice for a quick snake lesson. We had one of these in an earlier show. Gray rat snake, it serves an important ecological function, believe it or not. It may not look like it. And this is a healthy one, but they eat a lot of rats, critters that need to be have their population kept under control in the outdoors. So, boy, you don't see them this big very often, though. It's a nice one. In fact, you don't see snakes as often as you used to. Many of the non-poisonous snakes used to be more frequent, I remember, as a child. And some conservationists, scientists, are concerned that the snake population may be dwindling in some areas. Maybe that doesn't make anybody unhappy, but it's the healthy snakes, the helpful snakes, I think, that may be the ones that are disappearing for a number of reasons. The way we manage our forest, pesticides, herbicides, some of those things may be contributing to the problem, plus our own encroachment into the wild habitat of creatures with subdivision development and other things. This one, however, does adapt. So if you find one in your yard or your barn, he's a helpful creature. Leave him alone and let him live. While we've got this non-poisonous snake, let's talk about how to tell a non-poisonous from a poisonous. One of the obvious things is the eye. Now, don't tell me you're not going to get close enough to look, but if you have the opportunity, here's a good way to tell. The eyeball of a non-poisonous snake is circular, the iris is. And in a poisonous snake, it's elliptical or slanted. Also, on the head of a poisonous snake, there'll be a pit. A little viper, that's why they call them pit vipers, in fact, a little pit on the side of the head. And some people say you can tell by the shape of a head. A poison snake has an arrowhead shape. That tends to be true, but as you can tell, sometimes a non-poisonous snake will appear to have that shape, too. And it looks just like they've got poison sacs back there, and they really don't. It's just the way they puff their head sometimes, or just the angle that they may happen to be lying. That's not a good indicator, but the eye pupil and the pit, and a third way that you probably also would not be interested in is the scales on the tail. Back towards the tail, on a non-poisonous snake, the scales will be overlapping. They'll be split, divided scales on the tail, whereas on a poisonous snake, it retains that single scale aspect all the way out the tail. We found this one in the woods, but it does adapt around human dwellings. And if you notice one near your home or barn, it's a helpful snake, so make room for him. That's what we're fixing to do. Let him return to his natural surroundings. This is a deer run
Deer tend to run the ridges pretty much in many parts of the state, many places, as here in the Oakmulgee. It might be faint for the viewers to see, but there's a slight path that's slightly detectable. Turkey's laying right in the middle of it. More game than just deer use it, but it is a deer run. I stopped at the truck, went by the truck and got my camera. We can make some interesting photography. I don't think that deer run will be a good shot, but tell you what, here's a nice sign of deer use. This is smilax, catbriar, some people call, and we can see where the deer have browsed off the end of it. Normally the smilax this time of year comes out with a nice tender green shoot with a leaf on it, and this used to be that way. Right now it's probably being digested in some happy deer's belly. This is the way it normally looks. Well, let's move on down the deer run. Ah, we didn't get very far. Take a look at this. This will tell us something about the history of this forest. Crepe myrtle tree down here in the woods. And that's evidence, of course, that the forest was inhabited back when it was first created. There were people living in this territory, and the government bought up the land, and you can still find signs of old habitation in here. Evidence that people did used to inhabit the Oakmulgee before it was made a national forest can be found in one respect from the old cemeteries that dot the forest ever so often. There's some interesting graves. There's one that says died 1886, and there's some others. Here's one, let's take a look at it. Let's see here. There's no name. It simply says, "May we meet again, my dear, dear friend." Yeah, someone's loved one. Way back here in the middle of the Oakmulgee National Forest. Yeah, let's move on. Here's some smilax that hadn't been browsed yet, because I'm going to browse it. This stuff is also edible for human beings. You want a bite? Not bad. Tastes a little bit like smilax. I think I'll leave that one for the deer. One of the interesting aspects about the Oakmulgee is it has a number of old growth pine areas that provide habitat for an endangered species in the U.S. And that's the red cockaded woodpecker. It's not a big woodpecker, it's kind of small. And it doesn't have a red head, it's just got a faint trace of red on it. And they're kind of hard to spot, in fact. You more or less have to look for their den to be able to tell that the woodpecker is even present. But the den is pretty easy to spot because, one reason, it puts pine tar around the outside of the nesting hole. And the reason it puts pine tar over there is to keep snakes from crossing it, and it works. If a snake tries to cross the tar, it tends to irritate the underside of the snake, and sometimes they'll turn loose of the tree and fall. In some places in Oakmulgee, there are big sand washes where it's just all sand that's washed down from eroded hillsides many, many years ago, back when there were not the proper timber management practices applied in here. A lot of erosion occurred. And we have these big sand washes, but now they're beginning to reclaim themselves, and there's some interesting things that grow in here, like, purple sneezeweed. And it's a really lovely little wildflower to me. And it will make you sneeze if you get too close to it. But it's one of the nice little things we find in these sand washes. Let's see what else we can find. Here's another creature you find in the sand wash areas frequently. Ouch! Prickly pear cactus. And don't ask me how they get down in here, but you can commonly find them in these sand washes, and they put a pretty bloom on them at the right time of the year. This is a sumac. It's not poison sumac, it's sumac bush or tree. And the Indians used to use the berries to make a tangy drink. And you can do the same thing because they are tangy. This is sort of representative of how rich and diverse the Oakmulgee is. Almost every part of Alabama can be found somewhere in the Oakmulgee, as we'll show you on our trek to Payne Lake. Cindy Oliver, that great wildlife biologist from the university on the other end of the state.
Hey. you gonna come on?
I'll just stand right
okay.
here. What are y'all up to, Cindy?
Today we're putting out liquid fertilizer in the lake.
Uh-huh. Is that part of the problem, part of the solution of resolving the excessive weed?
Well, in a sense it'll help in that it'll shade out some of the sunlight to the aquatic vegetation on the lower levels, but essentially we're putting out liquid fertilizer to enhance the fisheries.
What you got in the lake these days?
As far as composition,
uh-huh.
We're managing primarily for bass and bluegill.
Uh-huh.
We do have some crappie. We've stocked it with grass carp, which is what we're doing to work on the vegetation problem, and they are doing a pretty good job.
Cindy, the lake certainly has improved. I think I see some wildlife enhancement right over there, huh? Is that a wood duck box?
Yes, it is.
How many of those you got on the lake?
We've got about 10 or 11 still standing on the lake and a total of about 40 on the district itself, including our beaver dams and swamps and stuff like
yeah.
that. So here we don't get as good nesting success as we'd like, but in the beaver dams, the more excluded areas, we get some good results as far as their nesting use.
Because of its suitability, Payne Lake provides a primary recreation site on the Oakmulgee. In keeping with the multiple use approach, however, other parts of the forest may be managed to serve a different primary purpose. In a lakeside chat, Ranger Bobby Reiser explained the aims of the Forest Service in administering such a diverse mix of responsibilities.
We try for a mix. We may not get a happy balance, but we try to get a balance that will work for the piece of land we're working with, because the land, as you know,
besides the normal demands associated with managing the land resources, the Forest Service also is faced with the need for a certain amount of people management. Visitors to the forest sometimes make this task difficult.
One problem we find in a national forest sometimes is from the use of ORVs, or off-road vehicles, motorcycles, three-wheelers, and dune buggies. And I love riding those things as much as anybody, but I think we probably ought to take a little bit of care in some places so that we don't ride up the steepest places and cause problems such as we see here, which is pretty severe erosion. Here's another problem we frequently find in our national forest, and I don't know why it is, because it's a totally unnecessary problem. I've noticed that Alabama's kind of strange in this respect. Unlike some states, some of our citizens will drive 5 miles back in the woods to throw out their trash when they've only got to drive a mile down the highway to find the dumpster. But this is a problem we can easily do without in our national forests. All it takes is a little bit of care.
Come on, boy.
Yeah. That was a good walk, wasn't it? This national forest is my backyard, but it's also your backyard. National forests are part of America's natural heritage, and as our wild areas and our open areas gradually dwindle from human encroachment into the outdoors, our national forests become more and more important as wild areas, and we shouldn't take them for granted.
As part of our country's system of public lands, national forests are in essence owned by the American public, and the future of these lands is thus a matter of public concern. With a currently increasing demand for harvested timber, and that demand is expected to double in the very near future, national forests will likely be pressed to help supply the market. Therefore, the general public may wish to learn more about the management of our national forests and to more closely monitor such activities as the increasing use of herbicides, the continued conversion of hardwood forests to pine tree monoculture, and the construction of new roadways into remaining roadless areas. As the famous forester Aldo Leopold prescribed in his philosophy of a land ethic, we as Americans need to maintain an active concern and respect for our natural heritage.
These lands belong to you. It's your tax money that pays for them and pays for managing them. And I'd like to share something with you that ties in with Leopold's land ethic philosophy. It was written by an Indian chief back in the 1800s when we, the white man, were trying to talk him out of his land, and we offered to buy it because we were going to take it if he didn't sell it. And he wrote a letter to the then President of the United States, Franklin Pierce, and this is what he said. If we sell you our land, love it as we've loved it, care for it as we've cared for it. Hold in your mind the memory of the land as it is when you take it. And with all your strength, with all your might, with all your heart, preserve it for your children and love it as God loves us all. One thing we know, our God is the same. This earth is precious to Him. I can't add to that. I'd like to thank all of you viewers who've written in and responded to the TV program. The response has been very positive and very pleasing to us. We do hope you enjoy the program, and we hope that we're presenting the kind of material that you like to see about your home state, Alabama. My backyard, your backyard. So, we'd like for you to continue. So, until we meet again, may the forest be with you.
The preceding program was funded in part by the Alabama Association for Outdoor Education.